Hey! Hola amigos! Joe Ropaleski here, aka Jose Ole, and I'm out here at Hinckley Lake in Ohio, but I want to talk to you about a completely different place on the other side of the planet, where I recently had the opportunity to travel to. The Danugerang Field Center is on the island of Borneo in the country of Malaysia, and it was there that I traveled with some fellow students working on my own schoolwork, but it was when I met up with some of the researchers already at the center doing their own research projects that things really got interesting. But I don't want to rub it in, I want to reminisce, but this time I'm taking you with me as we go back to Borneo. Ready? Here we go. Okay, so from Hinckley Lake, here we go. I actually flew out just north of here from Cleveland, and this was one of the shorter part of the trips, only about 3 hours flying over the United States of America. But I had to touch back down into the United States of America in Los Angeles to start the longest, but not the last, part of the trip. This was about a 9-hour flight on Malaysia Airlines across the Pacific Ocean, only to slowly find my way back down to Tokyo in Japan. It was here that we obviously had to refuel the plane, stretch our legs, and give us a little break before we continued on our way. So once we were back on the plane in Japan and ready to head off, we were bound for Malaysia. However, peninsular Malaysia. We wouldn't actually be touching down in Borneo just yet, but rather the city of Kuala Lumpur. From Kuala Lumpur, it was another switch to another airline, but this time I was headed for the island of Borneo. Still in the country of Malaysia, I'd be heading down into the city of Sandakan, where I'd get my first taste of Borneo. From Sandakan, we would change forms of transportation to travel over land by van over to the Kinabatangan River, where at the junction we would unload all the gear from the vans to load it back up onto the last form of transportation for the trip, the boats. From here, we would head up the Kinabatangan River for the last and final leg of the journey to finally arrive at the Danugerang Field Station. Originally built in the 1990s, it wasn't until while doing some of his own research that Dr. Benoit Goossens found the facilities and saw an opportunity. He approached the Sabah Wildlife Department with the idea of setting up a field research and training center, and with that idea supported, Dr. Goossens received the remaining support through a relationship with Cardiff University and opened the center in July of 2008. To carry out research on biodiversity in degraded tropical forest habitat, to understand how wildlife is adapting to a mosaic landscape of oil palm plantations and tropical forest, and then to provide that information with the Sabah Wildlife Department to efficiently manage the Lower Kinabatangan Wildlife Sanctuary. And with increasing students, grant funding, and field courses visiting the center every year, the center has maintained self-sufficient status since its opening. Even with their own water treatment facility, the staff still had quite the task at hand when keeping the center stocked and ready for all the visiting groups. But with such an accommodating and welcoming staff, visitors could get energized and get out to see what the forest had to offer. One way to experience it is to climb up a ladder and sit on a tiny platform up in the canopy. Well, that's something I, of course, had to do, and was certainly glad I did, as it offered an incredible view that I experienced first thing in the morning as I watched the forest around me awaken. There's always something to see. Here's a test. Can you see it? How about now? Have an eye for it yet? Here's a few reasons why I just love the jungle. There it is again. I was completely spoiled every day. Walking out the door and seeing a wild orangutan moving through the trees. It's certainly not every day where you get to see a mother and a juvenile orangutan right up the tree. Whether it's during the day or the night, it's amazing what you can see around the Danugerang Field Center. Just be patient and open your eyes. So although I had the chance to get out and try my hand at my own scientific research, I have to admit, the most fun came when I was allowed to go out and tag along the heels of the researchers that were already way into their research projects. Like here, going out at night with Josie on her amphibian hikes, where she was collecting information on the seasonality to try and find out the best time to get out and do a frog study. Or when I met Alice, who was actually spending her year of undergraduate out in the jungles along the Kinabatangan tracking tarsiers. How cool is this? Being able to go out at night and actually follow the small primate, one of two nocturnal persimmons found in Borneo.
So the general direction is this way, but it doesn't tell me exactly where she is. You have to look. But right now, that's really loud facing there. But I'm just looking at a binder.
So for 3 hours at night in the jungle, I was able to track this amazing creature, the tarsier, one of two nocturnal primates found in Borneo. And we were able to follow them because Mom had a small radio tracking collar around her neck. So for 3 hours, I got to watch a tarsier do what tarsiers do in the jungle. When I tagged along with Jenny, I learned about her small mammal trapping research project, where she was going around investigating the gradient of the forest as it got further away from the river's edge. But first we had to do habitat analysis, where I found myself helping out by measuring tree heights, vines, logs, everything literally under the sun and under the canopy. But not all of the research projects going on at Danagrang happen on the land. There's plenty of times I found myself out in the boats. Like this, for example, with Danica, where she led a group explaining primate surveys. Here, we drove along the river in the boat, surveying different primate species that we were able to see up in the canopy. For example, the proboscis monkey, an amazing primate that I was able to see on my visit to Borneo. How about a closer look? This was certainly the first time I had ever seen a proboscis monkey, but they were pretty easy to spot between that nose and that characteristic behavior of crashing through the treetops. Here, Priscilla took us out during the afternoon to track the sleeping site for a slow loris. Priscilla's project was similar to Alice, in that during the evening she'd be going back out another 3 hours tracking this other nocturnal primate in Borneo. But now let's meet up with Luke. Recently finishing his master's, he's now working on his PhD studying the estuarine crocodile at Danagrang.
Okay, we're looking to assess human wildlife conflict in the region and hopefully work out why it's increasing, and to hopefully by looking at long-term movements we can work out when people are most likely to be attacked, why they're going to be attacked, and hopefully issue information to local people as to how to prevent that. That's the major aim. The genetics aspect is very much a side mission, but we're looking at the effects of the population bottleneck that occurred in the 20th century and how that's affected the genetic diversity of the state as a whole. Up until about 1950 or 60, there's a very strong population. People here don't really attack crocodiles because there's a local belief that they're the spirits of their ancestors. But the fashion industry in the 60s and 70s especially, crocodile skin was in vogue, and wallets and that kind of thing. There were huge declines and they were listed as endangered. And in Sabah they were protected in 1982, after which they recovered very strongly. Although they're still not at their previous level yet. There are two main capture methods we use, depending on the situations and depending on the habitat surrounding where the crocodile is. Either we use a hand net, that's useful if it's in light vegetation, and we can kind of get in there, especially with the smaller individuals. For individuals that are in open areas with no logs and vegetation around, we use a casting net, and that gives us a lot more range. We can get up to, we can capture about 7 to 8 feet away. And actually we have a higher rate of success with that than with the hand net.
Basically, how can you shine a light across a river and know what you're going up at?
When we're approaching a crocodile, we can kind of ascertain the size by looking at, firstly, the distance between the eyes, and that can give us an idea as to the overall head size. If we can see the head, we can work out the total length. Just by seeing the head, we can get an idea of the overall length and whether it's feasible to catch it or not.
So that's when you know when you're coming up on one pretty quick that you can say, too big. I'm not going to put that in the net. So when you say too big and we go rushing to the shore, come on, how big was that?
He wasn't that big, but he was too big.
Right.
2 minutes.
Not the best thing you want to hear when you're racing towards the shore is too big. That's fantastic.
He's fine, he's more scared of us than we are of him.
Right. I love that phrase. They're more scared of us. They just have more teeth.
Whoa.
That was big.
But after a number of attempts and a lot of searching, it paid off.
All right, so success. We're here off the Kinabatangan River with Luke and Duyo and Budin, and we got one. Ooh, there we go. How long did you say it was?
132.2 centimeters.
That's a good size.
So Luke, Duyo, and Budin moved quickly to mobilize the small young croc, both the safety of everyone in the boat and the croc as well. They wanted to move as quickly as possible to get all the different measurements that they'd be needing for Luke's study. Certainly the first focus would be to secure that mouth.
Maybe more than one, Budin.
Yeah.
Once the mouth was secure, placing a cloth over the eyes would help keep this young croc calm during the quick study.
Look with you,
in the bag.
Once the mouth and eyes were taken care of, the legs were tied up to help immobilize the croc.
Yes, maybe can. Because he can't push down on the ground now to roll.
He
can't really do much.
Alright, Budin. Good job.
Down on the
Luke took a number of measurements for his study, including length and weight.
5.58.
As part of the genetics study for Luke's research, Luke took a small sample along the tail of the croc for laboratory analysis back at DG. They moved fast to get the croc back into the water as soon as possible.
Wow.
Be free, little buddy.
Well done, team.
But just as quickly as I had found myself in Borneo, the sun was setting on my jungle experiences. But I had such an incredible time meeting some of the most friendly staff and researchers, where everyone was more than excited to share with me what they were doing out in the jungles around Daniel Garang Field Center, teaching me what they were doing, how they were doing it, and perhaps most importantly, why they were doing what they were doing. That's what made my experiences at DG the best. So hopefully you've had as much fun on this adventure as I have, because I certainly had a blast, but it doesn't have to end here. If you like some of the pictures that you've seen in this video so far, go ahead and like Daniel Garang Field Center on Facebook, where you can keep up with everything that's going on the other side of the planet. Or you could request getting their Jungle Times to keep up with everything that's going on out there. But if you really want to help and really want to take some action, take a look at Daniel Garang's wish list on Amazon.com. And don't be discouraged if perhaps a new microscope might be out of your budget. Anything from batteries, headlamps, to field tape will all be certainly very useful and get right out there doing research just as soon as you send it. So, Tarima Kasi to all my friends on the other side of the planet, thank you so much for a wonderful experience. And to all the rest of you, safe travels!